Welcome to the Homes and Construction Show. Today with me on set, I have engineer Dan Waswa, and we are going to look at how to prevent water on our buildings. Many of you have had issues after constructing your beautiful home. You've started living in it, you furnish it very well. Boom, a problem pops up. Water is all everywhere. Your walls are destroyed. You're having molds and you don't know what could have gone wrong. Today, everything is going to be answered so that we avoid making those mistakes that you have been doing. With our buildings that have been constructed, when we have engineers on site, after everything is done, you find, they tell you that the building is failing because the water is destroying it, the molds are everywhere. What goes wrong? What mistakes do we do as homeowners or building owners? And at the same time, what are the mistakes that our engineers do when they're on our sites?
Okay, thank you so much. It's a very good question. Now, we are on site.
Yes.
Someone has decided to construct, or he has really constructed his or her beautiful house, completed the house, very beautiful interior, used the proper type of materials, but at the end of the day, there's an effect of water. You start seeing molds in your building, you start seeing peelings off of paint from your building. As you asked, what are the mistakes? One, it is to both of us, the engineers and the client.
Right.
First, the type of material that you provided to the engineer, or the type of material that the engineer used, does it prevent water from seeping into the building? So you as a client, sometimes the engineer comes to you, asks for the materials, the good type of materials, but again you turn on changing, giving them another type of material that cannot prevent water from seeping into the building. So it is to both of us, the client and the engineer. Secondly, maybe faults by the engineer. Now, as I may take you throughout, maybe as we begin from the foundation. There is, after constructing the foundation, we lay on a polythene gauge. So, did the engineer lay it very well, or did the builders lay it very well to stop that moisture from penetrating into the building or into the upper structure of the building to spoil it up? So it depends. If the engineer, if they laid it poorly, then we'll have to experience water issues into the building. But then we also need to know, how does water affect the building, or which type, which areas? We also need all to consider all that. We have rainwater that can spoil the building, affect the building. We have groundwater that can also affect the building. So it depends. Where else is the roof affected, or is the underground affected?
For starters, we are looking at the foundation.
Yes.
Because you mentioned the polythene in the foundation.
Mm.
You also mentioned about the material.
Mm.
The engineer sits with the home owner, the owner of the building, and guides them on which materials to buy.
Mm.
Putting that aside, you as an engineer, you know the right
type of material.
Type of material that is authentic, that is advised to be used in construction.
Mm.
So why not advise me on that same point to avoid a bigger damage?
Mm. Thank you so much. We have received many questions in that category. You advise a client to buy a type of material, but at the end of the day, prices vary. The client says, I can have a polythene gauge. Maybe it is specified by the engineer, I need an 1,000 gauge. And then you go to the market, the 1,000 gauge is maybe 160,000, but we have also another gauge that maybe is 80,000. So the client varies and assumes this works like the other, but the engineer has specified, give me 1,000 gauge. On finding on site, the client has brought, some clients buy materials from themselves. Sometimes they trust the engineer to buy themselves. If you find it that you trusted the engineer to buy the materials for yourself, to buy the materials for the site, and he has brought a different type of material, then it is an effect of the engineer. Maybe he doesn't know what he's doing. Or maybe he forgot somewhere else. Something went wrong. But
he
forgot. Yeah, it is. This sometimes happens. But it is on a rare occasion. But it so sometimes happens.
Then you mentioned about the moisture.
Yes.
Being the one that affects. I thought it was water, especially for the underground. So how does the two marry?
Okay. Now, moisture is also called, in the layman's language, it is, I can term it as water. But in our language, I can term it as moisture. Because how does it penetrate? It penetrates through, from the underground, penetrates through the building. It looks for areas where they are damaged, or maybe the polythene is damaged, and then it will penetrate. And then at the end of the day, you will see molds in your building. How does it come? As I spoke about earlier, if this foundation is not treated very well, if this polythene is not laid on very well, you will experience somewhere a seepage of water into the building after the foundation. But then it is better to have a professional inspect the building, and then after every stage inspect, is the foundation done properly? There is something we call waterproofing. The different solutions that we use for waterproofing, the different materials we use for waterproofing. It is better to waterproof your building more so from the foundation, because the foundation determines so much what is going to have up.
What is waterproofing in this regard?
Oh, okay, now I can define waterproofing as a process of preventing water or moisture from penetrating into your building.
Could you break down for us that process, for what exactly you are supposed to do to avoid moisture from penetrating?
Okay. Now, normally we construct the foundation. Normally, the engineer is on site, the builders are on site, they construct the building normally, foundation normally. If it is a storage building like this one where we are standing, they will construct the columns, they will construct the foundation walls, the plinth walls very well. They will treat it with hardcore. Everything that is supposed to be there, the BRC is put there, the polythene is put there, but to avoid moisture from penetrating in the building, the solutions we need to use. Perhaps there is waterproof cement. It is on market, but it also depends on which type of waterproof cement. Not every type of waterproof cement prevents water. And also, it depends on the area of construction. The way I waterproof a terrain, the area that is maybe is not a wetland, is not the way I waterproof a wetland is not the way I waterproof an area that
like
is
a
not
normal,
a, yeah, normal area
ground.
For yes. So it depends. But then the solutions that we use, you can use waterproof cement. Those are called bituminous paints that we can use. You can also use, nowadays people are coming up with different solutions, different paints that you can apply that can avoid water from contaminating your building.
Now, at what point is that paint applied? Because apparently you are talking about...
We are talking about the foundation. Yes. Now, why is it called a paint? Because it's liquid. That is why you call it paint. It's liquid. It's now for the bituminous paint, it's black in color. For those of you who have seen construction of roads, you've seen it being applied on the road surfaces or into that different material. So here, it's a polymer. Eh? Why is it called a polymer? Because it's kind of a polythene. A polythene avoids water from penetrating into your building. So this polymer avoids the water from seeping into these materials, into those bricks. It does not reach. It's like a coating that is applied onto the surface of the bricks to avoid that moisture from affecting the bricks or penetrating into the building.
So in cases of penetrating, the moisture penetrating through the walls, what extent can it affect, or what extent does it go up to?
Okay. Water penetrates through the building. It's a process, it's called a capillary rise. Capillarity, that it is a process from the foundation to up. So when it is, it moves to, it has a level where it ends and then it will go back down. So we have that height of 1.5 meters, that is 4.9 feet. So when it reaches that level, maybe call it window level, it will not continue. It will have to go back down.
Okay.
Yes.
So when it goes back down?
It is a process of movement that it reaches a certain level, it cannot rise, but again, it has to go back down.
But
so it's a process.
Continue doing it regularly.
Yes.
Causing that bigger effect that we will always notice after some time.
Of course, if you don't treat. Yes.
Now at that point, what are the signs that a layman can see and know that now this is the effect of water, or maybe the effects of having the wrong foundation for the building?
Now, as a layman, you have constructed your building very well, assuming you have used proper materials, assuming your foundation is laid on very well, everything is done well, but at the end of the day, you experience uncomfort in your building, in your house. You see molds. There is, after applying maybe tiles, there is always that white thing you can see always,
so
but
like
it's
a feel like,
yeah, it's a white feel like, yeah, like flour, like powder. So they're called molds. When you see them in your building, just get to know there is a problem of water in your build, in the foundation, in your building, in the entire building. So another thing, after applying paint, you see that bubbling off. Yes, you see maybe when you pull off that paint, the sand is coming off. Yes, coming off from the building. There's an effect. Just get to know there's water, there's moisture in your building. But how? Before even doing that, when you experience the molds and seeing that, when you see the peeling off, call a professional to do the structural integrity of your building, to study the building very well and find out what could be the problem, where could be the problem. We may think that maybe it is moisture from up, but then we usually have pipes of water into the building. We may find that maybe there is a leakage somewhere that is causing that. So it is better to first investigate, call a profession, to investigate and find out what is really the problem or what is really causing that.
You say that very effect. I've always thought that I've always blamed the engineers, saying that they cheated me on cement, because if it was concrete, real concrete, and with the right measures, we couldn't be having such a problem. So can that moisture affect concrete to that extent?
Yes, it can. Yes, it can.
But after how long?
It depends on... I cannot say within how long, but again, it depends on the type of concrete that was casted.
Okay. Also the measure of concrete.
If the ratios were mixed wrongly, you may experience it. If there is any area that can allow the movement of water, you will experience that effect in your building. So the best alternative is to avoid an area where water can really say, it's okay, now I can pass. Yes, it's the best alternative to avoid. But remember, we cannot avoid water in the building, but just have to treat it so that it stays underground, so that it does not affect.
Engineer, the advantage that we are having right now is that we are having you. To me and my viewer out there, who has heard about everything, they would perhaps want that breakdown from an expert of how the right whole foundation should be to avoid effects of water eventually. Please break for us down briefly before we go.
Okay, thank you so much. Now, the foundation, I have my building plan. I set the building how it's supposed to be. They start excavating those trenches, or maybe the columns, the pillars. After casting the concrete, there's something called blinding. Usually what we do, we do not put bricks after excavating. We do not put bricks down to the soil. There's that concrete we put there first. Most people take it for granted, all say it is wastage of material, but the way you keep your body clean is the way we keep this structure clean. The structure to give you the body, to give your body, to give you what you want, you have to keep it clean. Also, the structure to suit what it's supposed to do, to give you that good habitation, you're supposed to make it and give it a clean environment. Now, we get our bricks, we do not put them onto the soil. But before, it's called blinding. In a layman's language, we put there concrete, a mixture of sand, cement, and aggregate. But it's a small layer, just to make sure where I am, just to have a clean environment where I'm going to put my brick, so that it is not affected. After, lay on your bricks very well. Put there materials that are supposed to be there, the hoop iron to hold the structure very well, the right mixtures. Then, now we are at a level of the slab. Gone are the days back, people didn't want to lay slabs. Saying no, construct my building and after add on, you'll come back and put in concrete and then do the screeding, the floor, the flooring. But nowadays we advise, have the slab. There are many things that are done in slabbing. That is one, we prevent moisture from coming up. How? After me laying the foundation, the brickwork, the plinth walls, I will put on the polythene gauge. I will lay it very well to avoid moisture from penetrating. This polythene gauge avoids moisture from penetrating. Or before even laying on the polythene, you have to have hardcore in it. You backfill properly that malam, put in the hardcore. The hardcore has those pores that allows movement of water. Yeah. It is an advantage to us because one, movement of water to the polythene, and then it reaches the polythene and then it goes back down. So that is why. Or before, treat the foundation with a bituminous paint. It's a black surface. You can also use a waterproof cement. It depends on the quantity, or maybe depends on what the engineer has advised, on the engineer on site what has advised. But the most that I have used, and it is what is recommended most nowadays because of our seasons, changing seasons, we use bitumen paint. Yes. So if the foundation is done well, have that paint. There's a screed that is put on the bricks, and then have the paint on, and then you're good to go. Yes.
So when we do that, we are preventing ourselves, our buildings, from failing. We are preventing our buildings from being affected by water.
By water.
Thank you. Now we've been looking at the foundation because you told us how that water can be affected, but then you also mentioned of this other water, maybe rainwater, that affects buildings. Let us look at that and also talk about it. How can I prevent that water from falling on my building and affecting it?
Okay. Now, rainwater, assuming maybe your roof is leaking, there is a leakage somewhere, expect water to penetrate into your building, maybe to your ceiling, and then you have those peelings onto your ceiling. You usually see them in some buildings. If you have a leakage in the roof, you will experience there is penetration in penetration of water into the building through that tiny hole that into the iron sheet, and then it will penetrate and then the drops onto the ceiling. But with time, it takes time. With time, you'll see white peelings or brownish peelings onto the ceiling. Just get to know there's something wrong up, and then you have to investigate and find a solution for it. Either maybe you apply Bondex onto that hole where water is seeping from, or if it is a big effect, you can change the iron sheet and then have a new one. Yes, but also we have this fall of water.
Exactly.
You ought to have maybe harvest the water very well so that it does not affect the building. If maybe the water is not harvested very well by maybe the plumbers, then it will have an effect. Of course, it will run to the ground, and if your drainage is not done properly, automatically it will come to the ground, and then after it will penetrate back to the building. Mm. Yes.
Because where we are now, it's a site.
Yeah, it's a site.
The good thing is that water is just showing us how it is dropping, it has found way to the building.
Good. The advantage we have here is that we are on a roofing part of it. We are going to roof, but then after roofing, we shall have to. So this is rainwater that is dropping that you see. Because we haven't yet roofed, we haven't yet put the iron sheets. But as you can see, it is well demarcated. We shall have the run of water and we shall have the drainage properly. Yes.
Now, what is the standard of roofing? Because like the iron sheet should be used to make that water not fall on my building, but maybe a little bit.
Now, it depends on the design. It depends on the design of the building. It depends on what the building was designed for and depends on the design of the building. The engineer on site, if you have a qualified engineer on site, or you have an agent of an engineer on site, will always know the runoff and the type of material, the iron sheets to use. Yes.
Engineer.
Yes, please.
After me seeing the effects of water, maybe moisture, the molds, the powdered element in our tiles, should we think that all hope is gone? Should I demolish the house? Now start afresh, look for a professional engineer and build afresh?
Now, it depends on how great the effect is or how the house has been damaged. That is when you asked me, I told you have an assessment of the building. Call a professional to assess your building and find out how it has been affected by moisture. Remember those molds you've heard about, people say, I am allergic. Those molds cause allergy to some people.
Yes.
Now, how far? If the assessment gives you that maybe your building needs to be cut down, yes, now the report will tell you, you need to demolish the house or the foundation is affected. The report will always be telling you, demolish this, all it is a minor, we can treat it like this. I said, you can find that maybe it is a leakage of a pipe. Then maybe, well, you need just find a plumber to fix that. Yes, it doesn't require you to put off your building. Yes, but again, you will find somewhere else that maybe the foundation is affected. Or maybe also this upper structure is affected and really it cannot hold. the only solution may be there, you need to remove off that plaster and treat the foundation or treat the brickwork and then replaster again. Yes. It is better, that is why maybe I'll take you to the other side of the doctors. When they find the wound cannot be treated, they will tell you, okay, let's cut off.
But in an event when it can be?
It can be treated, it can be treated. So what will tell you that? That is a report after assessing.
So in this case, where there is still hope, where that brickwork can be worked on and treated?
Yes.
What is the process? And what does it take for one to have that problem solved?
Okay, for most of the times we advise, if the building is totally affected, we run a structural integrity test. Can the building still serve its purpose? Can this area of the building still serve its purpose? You may find this area of the building is affected, but the other area is not affected. It only needs you to only repair this side, yes? And also treat the other side to avoid what is happening, the same problem this side, to move to the other side. But then here, if you find it that it is affected to the extent that maybe it cannot hold, you're going to replace. You're going to replace. If they find malaria in your body, they're going to give you treatment. So here comes to the building. If we find it that maybe the bricks are affected, we are going to change the building. We are going to give it a surgeon. We are going to break that area and then rework on that area. So after the foundation, you lay on after that brickwork. Now, this is concrete all along from down. Yes? From down, from the ground, we have concrete. We have iron bars that are running from the ground level to this level where you see it now. Yes? But then we have the foundation, we have the brickwork down there. So we had to lay after the plinth walls, after our foundation, we had to lay this polythene onto before we could make maybe sit on the ground beams or maybe sit on anything.